the Bees in My Blood. By Errol Fisher. After an exhausting flight beneath the summer's sun, death gave ascent to an atmosphere that was already humid enough to suffocate anyone unfortunate enough to breathe it. It was not the gag-inspiring stench of an already dead carcass, but pheromones with the smell of one's own impending passing. Death in the name of Hive and Infinite Almighty was an honor for the 75,000 insectoid soldiers of the sky, clad in black and yellow stripes while humming a song of war as they waged such as if to be one body. Honeybees, when they departed their nest by the Legion, half of them knew they would never return. Sacrificing their life for the sake of the swarm, they were the pagan gladiators of the sky armed with stingers instead of swords. Honey was their life, which only lasted 30 days or so, yet each one was devoted to the sweet liquid gold. It came at a price if it were to be worthy of its ancient association with the gods. It would take a bit more than pollen and nectar collected from the finest of fluorescent flora. It was the duty of the elder sisters to provide such and the duty of the middle sisters to acquire it. On this day a beast would have to be sacrificed on the first day of summer in order to ensure divine quality of the sweet godly goo until the air begins to chill towards the middle of the autumn. It has been that way since the very beginning of time. As far as the honeybees are concerned, the best harvesting is done with the blessing of the infinite almighty honeybee god. But the honey prepared for the honeybee god requires an extra special ingredient for a proper offering. All of the elder sisters were prepared to perish for the common goodwill of their beloved hive and grace of their almighty infinite honeybee god. It was the bee god who would make the flowers bloom with an excess amount of pollen and nectar. Every sting was a sacrifice as each elder left their poisonous stingers in the flesh of the beast as they detached and fell to the ground to die. By the thousands they proceeded with their suicidal aerial assault on this beast as the middle sisters invoked chaos by cutting off all angles of escape with sporadic orbiting like tiny vultures. Mrs. Robinson was far too old to outrun the honeybees, and with so many bees engulfing the entire area, she was lost in her own cornfield. The old lady attempted to scream for her husband, but the mouth and nose are the first places the honeybees would prefer to invade, stinging inside the cavities, causing the tissue within to swell, blocking all oxygen needed to breathe. Her face had become plump. 70% of her body was polluted with the fanatic swarm of honeybees. Captain Baxter, her 10-year-old Irish red and white setter, barked and yelped as the honeybees extended their wrath to the woman's four-legged companion who refused to leave his owner's side. His yelps soon became a slow whimpering and then nothing. It was not long before they both lay incapacitated on the brink of their final breaths amongst the scattered corn Mrs. Robinson was harvesting for the state fair and the dead and dying bees that pursued her. It was at this moment that the middle sisters began their descent to the corpse of the woman. It was time to collect what they came for, which would bring blessings of the infinite almighty bee god and glory to the hive until the autumn chill. One by one the sisters began to retrieve the stingers of their fallen elder sisters. They then used the long flexible tubular tongues to collect the blood of the beast. All the blood collected was stored in their honey belly located in the honeybee's abdomen, an internal cavity that is normally used when collecting nectar from various flowers. All the middle sisters filled themselves with the blood of the sacrificed, and by the thousands they began the extremely long journey back to their nest. As they arrived, they were mostly greeted by the younger sisters who were obligated to relieve the middle sisters of the contents within their honey belly. Just as they would normally do with sweet plant nectar, they regurgitated the bitter nectar of the beast for the younger sisters to transport to the six-sided compartments called cells in the honeycombs, which were already halfway filled with honey. Once the final ingredient was added, just as they would normally do, they sealed each of the cells with wax. As this task was completed, the relieved middle sisters would begin a prayer in motion. Pheromones and body movement being the main tools of communication for the honeybees, this is also how they also attempted to communicate with the almighty infinite honeybee god up above in the heavens. As sure as the sun rose the next morning, the heavenly mist which signified the arrival of the most gracious honeybee god who made the flowers bloom in great abundance. This divine mist filled every one of the honeybees within the nest with an overwhelming euphoric bliss that did not come natural to the honeybees. They loved the honeybee god as much as they loved their delicious honey. It was more powerful than any beast that roamed the land, and so their poison had no effect on the honeybee god, which kept them in awe and to some degree even fear. The honeybees watched in relief as the honeybee god stalked off with the offerings. Peter Jinsky had come from 6 generations of beekeepers. It was the life of his entire bloodline. His 4-year-old daughter Amelia waited patiently for the first jar of honey to be complete, because fresh honey and butter on a golden brown buttermilk biscuit was her favorite morning delight. Bee farmer Jinsky packed up the rest of his jars in the back of an old Chevy station wagon. They were carefully packed individually in a cheesecloth sack. The insides were coated with a hay. Bee farmer Jinsky drove off into the horizon to the place that his family annually made a small fortune in the retail of honey. The state fair, which is where vendors from miles and miles around sat in the longest of lines to purchase as much of the finest honey in the South they could afford. The property was once again further sustained by the blood sacrifice of the fanatical honeybees of the Jinsky Farms, as it has been since the beginning of their time. The end. Thank you for listening. I hope you enjoyed. Please follow me at The Adventures of Errol Fisher on Twitter, YouTube, Instagram, and Facebook. Have a great day. The Bees in My Blood. By Errol Fisher. After an exhausting flight beneath the summer's sun.